Okay, part two, here it is. I've been escaping our current pandemic reality by binge watching some pretty trashy Netflix shows recently. But today I am turning my indulgence into an educational opportunity. As a parent coach, I have been so fascinated by this Australian docuseries called Yummy Mummies that follows four gorgeous, high-class Melbourne mums as they navigate pregnancy, postpartum, and motherhood. And to my surprise, though their lavish lifestyles are a far cry from the existence that most of us know, these women still face really universal struggles of parenting young children. And so I thought it would be fun to put on my coaching hat and share with you just how I would help one of these yum mums through her season two, episode five quandary about how to best give her son a leg up in the competitive process of admissions to selective private schools in her area. Jane Scandizzo's eldest son, Jagger, is nearing the time when he'll enter preschool. And like many parents, she wants to make sure that he's prepared. He can hit the ground running and he'll succeed once he begins.
Even though Jagger's only 3 years old, I want to get Jagger into the best schools available. And to do that, I have hired a tutor today to find out his strengths and weaknesses.
I deal with a lot of parents who are in a very similar situation to yourself with pre-prep. So I do have a list of things that can help you with school readiness.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm dying to see this list. But if my instincts are right, I've got this strong sense that it reflects a purely academic approach to readiness. And it's likely to hold a list of skills that preschoolers and kindergartners are working on while in school. This, to me, is a really worrisome trend in our education systems. We focus way too heavily on performance measures such as recognizing letters, numbers, and colors, ignoring the much more critical life skills like getting along with others, self-care, problem-solving, being able to communicate one's needs and thinking and playing creatively. We also tend to look ahead at what's expected of a preschooler and then try and instill those skills in our children before they begin. So rather than having a year or two of school to master a skill, we think a child is only going to be able to succeed if they know these things before they even set foot in a classroom. And thus, our standards start to creep downward, and all of a sudden, we're really worried and disappointed when a four-year-old can't read when that's not developmentally appropriate until age seven. So, if Jane were my client, I would very much want to see this list and make sure that her son was being assessed on a broad range of skills across every area of development: social, emotional, physical, cognitive, and that he wasn't being pressured to perform at a level that's beyond what's expected of his age. Okay, let's see what else this tutor has in store for Jagger.
I have brought a little friend along to see you, and his name is Milo Monkey. Oh, yes, Milo Monkey has said he would love to read some of this to you.
Okay, Milo Monkey is in the building. I'm really curious to see how he's going to assist with school readiness.
It's very interactive for the children and what we call multisensory. Is it engaging? Oh, yes, Milo Monkey is going, that's Milo Monkey saying letter M or is for his name.
Now, I can tell that the tutor has really good intentions here, but she is missing or misunderstanding some really critical elements that I want to address. Yes, we do want learning to be engaging and we want it to be multisensory. That means it's play-based, incorporates movement, and is rich in sight, sound, smell, taste, and touch. And this is true for any age, but especially during early childhood, learning should never feel like instruction. It should arise naturally through daily life activities and through independent, creative free play. Unfortunately, being read a book about letters and sounds with a monkey sitting on the reader's shoulder just isn't the ideal learning experience. And that's because nothing about the concept that this tutor wishes to teach is accessible to Jagger in the moment. He's not involved in the exploration, and he's not an active participant. He's simply witness to it. And the monkey, totally distracting. Do I look at the book? Do I look at the reader? Do I look at Milo? Not to mention the fact that the skill of recognizing a letter and knowing its sound and then connecting that to an object is just beyond Jagger's capacity. So if the goal here is to enhance his literacy skills, here's what I would advise Jane to do instead. Have printed words, especially his name and other familiar words and proper nouns, visible in the house. I would put those magnetic letters on the fridge for him to play with whenever he feels like it. When you're out drawing with chalk, you could pause and sign your artwork, spelling your name as you go. Jane, J-A-N-E, that's mine. Oh, and here's yours, J-A-G-G-E-R, Jagger. Also, you can be really silly and playful with your use of language to start hinting at patterns. So let's say you're at the grocery store, you could grab a cantaloupe and exclaim, "What a massive mouth-watering melon!" Also, continue reading books together and don't feel pressure to make it a linear process. She could let Jagger flip the pages, pause to talk about the pictures, go backwards, stop in the middle if you'd like, especially if Jagger's really getting inspired to play or create a scenario that's based on something he saw or heard in the book. And lastly, I would advise never to test a child or to make them endure a lesson, especially at that age. Just focus on real life exposure to letters and words and follow their interest. Okay, back to Jane.
I'm finding Jagger is really smart. He loves his books, he loves drawing, and he's got really good concentration.
There is. So that's pretty good. He knows his colours already, so that's excellent.
Little Jagger is doing so well with the stickers.
This is wonderful. Jagger got engaged with a fun activity that had learning naturally built into it. He wasn't being instructed or tested, he was simply playing, and that allowed his mother and the tutor to reflect on his strengths. At this point, going forward, here's what I would say to Jane or to any other parent out there who's wanting to prepare their child for preschool or kindergarten. First, prioritize independent time where your child can be, as infant and toddler specialist Magda Gerber put it, the script writer, the director, and the actor in their own play. Make space in everyday life for this uninterrupted, open-ended free time. This is really where children build those critical skills of confidence, problem solving, risk taking, creativity, and so much more. Second, supervise and facilitate interactions with siblings where your child can experience all of the social stages of play. This will be so incredibly useful when they transition into a classroom setting. Third, invite your child to be an active participant in daily life activities such as cleaning, cooking, and caring for your environment through chores like watering plants, feeding the dog, etc. These moments constitute a large part of the day in a preschool or kindergarten setting, and so building familiarity and enjoyment in those things now will really set them up for success. Fourth, I would say to make plenty of time in the day for children to master self-help skills like toilet learning or getting dressed. Having that foundation of body awareness and a real care for oneself is absolutely fundamental in those early years. It allows children to feel competent and in control, and then it's going to free up more space in their school day to get back to the classroom activities that they're passionate about. As a former preschool teacher, it made no difference to me how high a child could count or whether they knew the colors of their clothes. What I always really hoped to see was a child entering my room with a thirst for learning, who persists through challenges, who shows love and care for the toys and their classmates and for themselves. This is truly what matters at a young age. And this is what matters for all of us as human beings for the rest of our lives. All of those academic skills, we can work on those things with children as long as they are equipped for the challenge. So those are my thoughts on school readiness for three-year-olds. Thank you to Jane and the Yummy Mummies for giving me some material to work with and giving me the chance to share my ideas. If you would like more content on raising young children, subscribe to my channel and check out my other videos and links. Thanks so much for watching.